What about the other ones? What's the word on them?
The process is still ongoing. We never discuss the results till all the testing is complete.
Sorry, fellas. Come back down here in the morning, 9 o'clock sharp.
No.
What?
I said no. Look, we did what we said we'd do. We came in here like guinea pigs and let you test us, but that's it. We've had enough.
I ain't coming back again.
You're saying that you're no longer willing to cooperate.
That's all we do is cooperate. And all we get back from you is grief.
Mike, we need a little bit of time.
No, Mike, I'm sick of this shit. You want to press charges? You go ahead. You do it now. We told you everything we know, and if that's not good enough, that's too damn bad, because that's all there is. Let's get the hell out of here.
What are you saying, son?
Well, Blake, my charts don't lie. You ask me, those boys are telling the truth.
I think we can be rather certain that this incident occurred, that they're not lying. What they claim happened did happen, and it's not a hoax.
The fact that I have to make the audience believe this extraordinary thing has actually happened to me, and if I can do that, it'll be a great victory for me, because it's not a matter of getting them to believe that your dog died or that your car won't start or that you broke up with your girlfriend. It's asking them to believe something quite extraordinary, you know, of biblical proportions. And that was what initially got my attention when I read the script, that central challenge of making, we're not making a special effects supernatural movie. We're making a movie about ordinary people where something extremely extraordinary happens.
You know, Robert, what about you? Are you an UFO believer, generally?
Well, if I can believe I'm a Terminator, I think I can believe this. I've had the theory, I think that Carl Sagan said it best, that we'd have to at least, you know, we can't be that arrogant not to consider that there could be something else out there. So I came into it like that. And then after I met Mike and Travis and talked to them at length about what they had experienced, I totally believe their story.
You do?
Totally.
So you believe that there are creatures out there who are far advanced technologically over us and even come and visit time to time?
I believe that these guys went through a very traumatic experience. I believe what they've told me. And as I said, going into the movie, I've always had the idea that it is a small universe. And we are a tiny speck, so we have to at least be open-minded enough to consider the probability.
Okay, let's give Travis Walton, 44 years later, he's still here, he's still talking about this. I don't know why people don't believe it, but let's give him a big hand for sticking out. I mean, this is the guy, really.
Thank you, appreciate that. Well, time is brief. I'm going to speak quickly, run through it so that we do have time for some Q&A. November 5th, 1975, ordinary work day for seven guys. The movie kind of reduced the size of the crew, but there were a number of changes in the movie, and so if you're looking for a documentary, that's not the place to go. But it does share with you the emotional meat grinder we went through at the time. Even, you know, watching those clips from the movie, you know, just, really takes me back there to what I was feeling at that time. But some people say, forest, loggers in the middle of Arizona, isn't that all cactus and desert? You know, but it's actually the largest ponderosa pine forest in the world, stretching all the way from end of New Mexico up to the Grand Canyon. So There was the other six guys that were with me. Mike is the crew boss in the upper left there. Youngest guy, Steve, on the lower right. Upper right is Alan Dallas. And Alan was really, really was a hothead. And the importance of bringing out that sort of conflict was, we weren't some close-knit a group of guys in on some kind of crazy conspiracy. One guy there, the guy in the lower left, had only been there 3 days. So it was just a bunch of guys coming home from work, and this incredible thing happened. In the movie, they said Alan saw it first, but I don't know who saw it first, because it wasn't any, oh my God, what's that kind of a thing at first. We just saw this glow coming through the trees. It was starting to get dark. We'd been putting in long days, you know, and worked right up till dark. And I could see this glow. This was part of where we hadn't cut the trees yet, so it was real, really pretty thick there. And I just thought kind of idly, could that be sun going down over there? No, that was earlier. Could it be the moon? No, moon's over here. We had heard some shots in the distance during the day, so thought maybe it might be deer hunters camped up on the ridge there. But light was coming from higher than where ground level would be. The term fire in the sky come from an experience we had on the way to work. One morning, we were driving along, and there was a tree that was on fire up high. So we stopped and put the fire out. Very often, the Forest Service will come and get us before they get the professional firefighting crews to help put out fires, because we're already there. We know how to do this stuff, and we've got equipment ready to go at a moment's notice. So that's where the term fire in the sky came from. Is that, that was one of the possibilities. We're seeing this glow coming through the trees. Could there have been another lightning strike? Lightning strikes are monitored by satellite or something. Anyway, they keep track of this stuff. And that Mogollon Rim area there in the Sitgreaves National Forest has the highest frequency of lightning strikes of any place in the United States over land. There's one that's a little higher over the Everglades, but that's over water. And the significance of that is why they were there. Why were the aliens there? You know, some of the guys on the crew thought, oh, they were just laying for us and wanting to catch one of us. But I never liked that theory because, anyway, the thing with the lightning was explaining why they were there. We had afterwards gone into looking at possible geological survey maps. Could there be some mineral under the ground there that they would be interested in? Underground springs, water, or something like that. Nothing was adding up. They looked at the magnetic lines of force there. But I was on a show with Rob Lowe. Him and his sons had this TV show where they were traveling around the country looking into various paranormal events. And it was a two-part episode when it aired. They did my part, and then Rob says, to introduce the next segment, which was a lady that sells crystals as a vendor at events like this. And he said, well, Travis told me that the aliens were in the area there harvesting fulgurite. And I was startled by that because I didn't know what fulgurite was, never heard of it before. What the heck is fulgurite? So I looked it up online. And fulgurite is a type of crystal that is formed when a lightning bolt strikes the earth. And you've got millions of degrees and millions of volts forming crystals that are not formed geologically. So of any place in the whole United States, if they wanted that kind of mineral for some purpose, that would be it. And I just came from given a talk in Minneapolis, and there was a crystal dealer there, and she had this book, and I looked up fulgurite in that, and this was just a week or two ago, and it said that fulgurite is a crystal that is supposed to be involved in interdimensional stuff. And I go, you know, because, you know, one of the big objections that skeptics have about the possibility of extraterrestrials visiting us is, in terms of ordinary Newtonian physics, it would take years to get here, even at the speed of light, they claim. You know, they can't come here. But so it obviously involves some kind of cutting-edge type of physics that our own scientists are, you know, just getting into, you know, that this kind of stuff is actually possible, and they're coming up with the theoretical constructs and whatever for interdimensional stuff. And the stuff that Ray was saying about this sort of thing relating to an interdimensional thing really strikes a chord with me, because it does explain how they get there. It explains the connection with the lightning strikes and the fulgurite. Well, that's how we all fit in one truck, double cab truck. But John Gillette said that, you know, he was thinking, you know, that it might be the sunset and all this stuff too. And it was just kind of idle musing about what that glow might be. But I said, Mike, hurry up, get up there, let's see what it is. And there was a break in the trees where I could see the light was sort of shining onto the road there. And when we got to that point, boom, there it was. There was no doubt. Alan screamed out, it's a flying saucer. And our famous skeptic there on Larry King with us had one theory that it was the planet Jupiter. I mean, this was less than 100 feet away. There was no mistaking what we were looking at. I mean, instantly, everybody knew. And I got out and I went closer, fast at first, thinking it was take off like the bear did, you know, but it wasn't taking off. And I was kind of reluctant to show that I was that scared, but closer I got, the slower I got. When I got where I was looking up at about a 45, it suddenly got louder and started to move. So I just instantly reacted. I jumped down into a crouch behind a log there that was sticking up, and they were screaming, just like in the movie, you know, cussing me out, get back in here, let's get the hell out of here, you know. So I didn't need to be told. I was just kind of weighing the relative safety of this place behind this log and the safety of the truck. But I decided to run back to the truck. But when I stood up, bam, that's when this blast of energy hit me. And in the movie, they kind of drag it out. It was more of an instantaneous, explosive type of thing. It threw me, you know, some of the guys said it threw me 15 or 20 feet, to the point where John said his body fell like a sack of meat, like there wasn't a bone in his body. They immediately knew it had killed me. Steve, youngest guy in the crew, he said it got him, you know, and got him means, you know, like you got your deer, it's, you know, he's dead. So everybody screamed at Mike, go, get us out of here. So he took off, and they went up there and trying to decide. They said they argued about what to do at first, and then they caught sight of some deer hunters passing by on the other road up there, and they hurried up to try to catch up with those. Now, in the movie, when Mike says, we got to go back, we got to go see if, you know, if we can save him, if he's still alive, and they argued about it, and they said that Mike said, this truck is going back. Now, anybody that doesn't want to go can get out and wait right here, and we'll pick you up when we come back. They were that scared, but in the movie, they all volunteered to get out and wait, and Mike went back alone. In real life, nobody volunteered to get out. we're staying with you, we stay in the truck. So they all went back, and they said they called and looked for me, and it was pretty intense, terrifying experience, they say, and they're all huddled around one little flashlight, you know, just shoulder to shoulder. In the movie, there was this question, did they find the right spot? Is this where we stopped? No, there was no doubt, because when Mike took off, he spun those tires and dug a big hole in the earth, and, you know, they knew right where it was. So that was the place that they brought the tracking dogs when the search started. And from the local prison there, at Winslow, the dogs found a trail from there, from where I got out of the truck, up to where my body fell, and that was the end of that. The crew went back, called the sheriff, and that was, you know, they were so overcome with emotion. There was such a recently traumatized that when they were describing this to the lawman, well, he's missing, he might be dead. They perked up their ears like, oh, might be dead, huh? They're not going to buy this story about the flying saucer taking me away, but maybe these guys got in a fight, Travis was killed, they hid the body, and they couldn't come up with a better excuse than that. Well, you know, common sense would tell you that, oh, Travis went over the hill to use the bathroom and never came back. Maybe bear got him, maybe a mountain lion or something, you know? But so they had this massive search, you know, dozens of people on foot, horseback, helicopters, airplanes, and all these accusations, you know. John walking down the street, people say, murderer, yelling all kinds of stuff at him. And it was pretty hostile. Now, my oldest brother, Don, he thought that maybe they'd killed me, and that was his theory, and he had a violent confrontation with one crewman, that's Dwayne Smith, but my other brother, Dwayne by another spelling, believed them because he'd had a sighting himself 8 or 10 years before in the same woods. But there was a lot of heat going on during the search. Mike said that he saw this guy with a Geiger counter, and he went over there and said, well, you find any radiation? The guy said, no. He said, no, it's ticking. And the guy says, no, that's just background radiation. That's just 1.5. And he says, see? And he put it up to this radium dial watch, and the reading went up to 3. Mike said, well, test us. And so the guy said, see? 1.5, nothing here. Guy was really kind of hostile. He felt like this guy, these people were just playing him for a fool, and what's he doing checking for radiation? Mike says, well, look, we've bathed and changed our clothes. I'll get our hard hats. He went back to the truck and got the hard hats, and the Geiger counter went up to a reading of 6. Now, that's double what the radium dial watch was, so that was pretty hot stuff, and at that point, the Geiger counter man just wraps up his little instrument and stomps off. Didn't want to follow up on that story, but it was about some UFO researchers who went out there with these Gauss meters, 2 different models, and charted it all out. And there was a polarity reversal in the direction the craft had left. And the sheriff's files had reports from other hunters, fishermen, campers in the area who had seen the craft depart. But nevertheless, the accusation of murder intensified, and the men said, well, we're telling the truth. We'll take any damn test you want. Give us sodium pentothal, and pentothal, you name it. And so they set it up, went in there, and they tested Steve first, and found out later that he had passed, but at the time they weren't telling anybody the results. But when Alan got on there, the line of questioning was, would you, have you ever thought of wanting or attempted to do any harm to Travis Walton? Well, Alan's mother was on scene, and she was feeding this paranoia that this was all some kind of a setup, and that Alan was going to be the fall guy, because he knew he wasn't going to pass a polygraph test about not wanting to do harm to me. We'd gotten a fight 3 days before, right there in Mike's backyard, in front of the whole crew. He had gone out to, a sneaky guy, visit my girlfriend, and and telling her what a bad choice I was and how she ought to be with him instead, you know. So we got in a fight, you know, and that would have made him his test. So, you know, he pulled his sensors off and stomped out. He later went back with the same examiner, passed with flying colors, but that was the one little thing that the media needed to say, well, everybody passed, but there was this one, quote, inconclusive, which he didn't really actually take a test and at that point, but everybody passed tests, more than one, it went on and on. Steve says every time he got a new girlfriend, he went and took another test. But he told a story about going to his mom after he passed his lie detector test and said, see, told you we didn't murder him. And you know, I felt kind of sorry for Steve because you know, your own mother needs a polygraph test. You know, I'm telling you, Mom, I didn't kill this guy. And she says, well, okay, you saw something, but it had to be demons. And so there's no way to win that little argument. So, and it continued. Dr. Harder, who did the regressive hypnosis on me, made the remark that if you had six people who had witnessed a murder and all testified that they saw what they saw, that'd be an open and shut death penalty case in an American court of law. And here you got six people who are passing lie detector tests, and you're still going, maybe it could be something else, something else. And the theories got really wild, you know, planet Jupiter, it wasn't swamp gas, but, you know, that actually kind of entered into it. But all kinds of theories about what it might be. Dr. Persinger's theory was that the fault lines under the ground there had shifted and generated what's called earthquake lights, which was actually a lightning blast going back in the other direction through me, causing these hallucinations. And another theory was that it was a transitory psychosis, that I temporarily went insane. I can pass a lie detector test because I believe it happened, but it was all a hallucination. And another theory was we were all out there partying with chainsaws, getting stoned out of our minds. No, you gotta be on your toes to, or you're gonna have some serious wounds with chainsaw. But what was really goofy about this theory was that even if you could prove I was hallucinating, what about six other guys? You know, they saw what I saw, you know, it doesn't fit, but anything you can throw at him. And so I took a whole battery of psychiatric tests, a totally normal pattern of scores. I took, had blood and urine samples put through the Maricopa County Medical Examiner's drug screen. Showed no trace of any drug whatsoever in my body. But you know, that stupid theory popped up again and again. You know, anything that they can say about it, even though it's already been disproved, again and again, the evidence goes the other way. But people who don't want to believe something have their reasoning pattern backwards. They begin with the conclusion and then collect things to support it. What you're supposed to do is collect the facts and then draw a conclusion. You know, little fundamental problem here, you know, just like our famous UFO skeptic. There on Larry King, he said, that clip wasn't quite complete, but he was referring to me flying back and hitting the rocky ground. And in my medical examination right afterwards, they said, Philip Klass said, there were no bruises. He should have been bruised because in his book he said he hit the rocky ground. And then he just turns around a couple minutes later and says the ground was covered with a thick carpet of pine needles. Well, what is it? A carpet of pine needles or a hard rocky ground that should leave bruises? But he had it both ways. I mean, everything he could throw at it, it was all just a big conspiracy to get Mike out of his logging contract. Nope, Mike got affidavits from the contracting officers that no, this story couldn't have had done anything to end his contract. And when it did finally end, because he couldn't get a crew to go out there, the incident wasn't even brought up, wasn't even mentioned at the resolution of the contract thing. But theory after theory, you know, anything they could throw at us, accusations that got pretty nasty. Of course, they dig into everything he ever did that was the least bit questionable, and well, these people are just can't be believed. But what happened happened, and I think the weight of evidence is overwhelming. If anybody will objectively examine it, anything that is supposed to weigh against it never even happened. This, you know, there was a period of time where I went to work there at the paper mill and said, I'm just not going to talk about this anymore. So this guy jumps in there trying to get attention, saying that he was the sheriff's nephew and he knew all about it and in great detail. And he's describing everything that happened, including the drug hallucination theory. Supposedly, needle marks all over my stomach where I've been injecting hallucinogens. It's just, nobody uses that drug that way. And besides, the medical test proved there were no drugs, but he's saying it anyway, getting all kinds of attention that he was after. And he said that the crew met with the sheriff in the Red Robin Diner. Well, the Red Robin Diner didn't exist for another 20 years. And so people online jumped his case before I did. Now, there was no Red Robin Diner there, and there still isn't one. And he goes, well, I have a red onion. Well, there is a red onion there in Heber, but it too did not exist for another 20 years. But, you know, this was the kind of stuff that they were throwing at us. This guy claimed he went to school with my nephew and my son, and nobody could figure out who he was. I went to the sheriff, asked him, Marshall Flake, and he didn't have any idea who it was. So this is somebody inventing a whole thing to get attention. And not all of the inventions were negative. Some of my supporters made up stuff, you know. Guy said, yeah, Travis is a great guy. You know, I went to that homecoming party. Well, that was movie fiction. There was no homecoming party. So he couldn't have been at that party. I was in no mood to party, I guarantee that. I was hanging by a thread. I couldn't even finish a sentence until the hypnosis. Yeah? We'll have Q&A afterwards. What am I overlooking here? I'll get to that. I'm talking as fast as I can here. Never enough time to say it all. This is where they actually met the sheriff, not in any diner. You know, it looked great in the movie that it was some kind of restaurant. This was an active service station at the time. It's since then been bulldozed, but even Deputy Ellison came to believe us and actually came to speak at one of my conferences. Sheriff Gillespie and his one of these interviews that he did towards the end admitted that he sort of believed it. He felt obligated to play the part of the skeptic because he had all these people, redneck type guys who were his supporters, his clique, who didn't believe this stuff at all, even though Gillespie had his own sighting, you know, so he secretly believed this but didn't want to admit it publicly. And he put it on the movie, the Travis movie, in an interview. And also James Garner called me aside when we were on set and said, you know, I have to play the part of the skeptic here, but you know, I just want to let you know that I do believe you. Just playing the part of the lawman here. And over the years, some of Gillespie's relatives and friends had texted me and said, you know, privately he does believe, he just didn't want to say it in the public. But I gotta support this guy. You know, this was he had a great deal of integrity. There was an episode in my childhood, in my high school days, where I had come to appear for some minor ticket, whether it was speeding or loud pipes or something, and the judge was not there. The courthouse was locked up. So I sat on the step, waited 20, 30 minutes, and he didn't show up, went home. Next day I'm walking down the street, Sheriff Flake, Marshal Flake, arrests me, throws me in jail, locks the door, goes out, locks the courthouse door, and leaves me. I'm a minor, I'm a high school kid, you know? So I was really angry because, you know, this was like false arrest. He just wanted an excuse to search me, found nothing. and there's no place to sit down. The bed was soaking wet. The sink was ripped off the wall there. So, make a long story short, I broke out, went down to the county seat there, turned myself into Sheriff Gillespie, told him about this ridiculous thing. And so the local deputy, comes in there to take me back to Snowflake. And Woody Peterson was his name. And he says, yeah, we got us a real bad one here. Tore up our jail, tore the sink off the wall. Gillespie stands up and says, Woody, don't you lie to me. I was down there last week and that sink was torn off the wall then. And you know, for a sheriff to stand up and just confront his own deputy about the attempt to frame me for vandalism on the jail, the whole thing was dropped because they were in the wrong. It was false arrest. They did not go notify my mother. It was, I'm a minor. You can't do that. You can't leave minors alone. You know, those four high school students that were arrested in Payson, they left them there overnight and the heating system leaked and they all died of carbon monoxide poisoning. So, you know, the idea of locking somebody up and walking off was just wrong. But this man stood up for the truth. There was a massive surge, air. My first impression when I regained consciousness on board the craft was pain, big pain, desperate feeling of being mortally wounded. There's a scene. Oh, can we turn this mic off somehow? Okay, I don't know where the feedback's coming from, but okay. There's most of what you see aboard the craft in the movie is Hollywood fiction, and at the time, you know, that did a good job of showing you the fear I felt at the time, but it was really due to just completely misunderstanding the situation. It was a desperate situation in terms of being mortally wounded. I probably actually was mortally wounded. Something was definitely very wrong inside. They had this thing laying across my chest. This is just blurry because that's the way I am. When I opened my eyes, that's all I could see. It was just, and it hurt. Any light coming into my head hurt. I could hear the sounds of movement around me. I eventually remembered approaching that craft, you know, but I assumed that, you know, my idea at the time, run back to the truck, that, you know, somehow I'd been hurt and that the crew would take me to the hospital. I could see these forms around me, people moving, and I thought it was doctors, maybe a white surgical cap and mask with a darker area in between. But when my eyes, my vision cleared, it was definitely not doctors. And I just freaked out, totally freaked out. Now, the one scene on board the craft where the actor has this membrane over his face and he's struggling to scream, struggling to breathe through it, it didn't happen, but I think it does a much better job of showing the feeling of suffocation that was adding to my panic. So many people said, I wouldn't be that scared. I would just stay calm, ask good questions, slip a souvenir in my pocket, you know. And so I tell them, you would have had to been there, you know. I felt like I was dying, you know, and these creatures that I saw that were just, it was automatically to assume that they were responsible for it. It was only in hindsight, afterwards, it took me years to realize that the fear I was feeling was not justified, that they weren't, you know, the media reported as they took him on board to do medical experiments on him. Well, I don't think it was medical experiments. I think it was a medical treatment. Rather than being an abduction, I came to prefer to call it an ambulance call, that I was accidentally hurt with this blast of energy, and there was no technology on earth that was going to save me. Nearest hospital is an hour away. None of the guys in the crew knew CPR. So that was a dawning realization. Now, Barbara Lamb is here, and I heard her giving a talk once where she had done regression on people who initially thought that they'd had a very negative experience and then come to realize that they'd had medical problems that were resolved. So it's kind of like the little kid who goes to the dentist, you know. It's painful, it's scary, it's terrifying. So that man in the white coat is a monster that's out to hurt him. When if he understood it, you know, this is to help you out, and in the long run, it's gonna be better. So I was terrified beyond description, the level of fear. I compared it to the effectiveness of waterboarding, an interrogation technique that is used on the enemy, who is perfectly aware that there's this thing called waterboarding. But it still works. I mean, they even train for it. They practice it, do it. But, they, you know, eventually people on our side decided that was too mean and we shouldn't do that anymore. But, you know, our own guys were training for it and going through it. And nobody died. But it was so terrifying and so over-the-top torture. That's what it was compared to. But it still worked. And so that was the feeling of suffocation that I was going through. I don't know whether it was a neurological injury because of that blast of energy hitting my head, or an actual physical damage to my lungs from this blast of energy. But whatever it was, I felt like I couldn't get enough oxygen. And it added to my panic in a way to where, you know, my fear was just over the top. I mean, I was terrified, assuming that I was dying and I'm fighting for my life. I grabbed up an instrument and swinging at him and managed to frighten him away, or maybe they just figured that it's not going to work. I went to escape. This was the nightmare image that came back to me in my dreams for months, years afterwards. It was those eyes. The eyes boring into me like that. I had a doctor in my audience say, well, you know, the largest opening in the front of the skull are the eyes, and these very oversized eyes would be, you know, the stare would have to do with them trying to regain control of you. This mind control thing is a telepathic sort of thing. And that makes sense to me. One thing that never came up in all these years, that I keep hearing about these creatures called grays, having lost emotion. They can no longer experience happiness and love and the kinds of emotions that we feel. So they're curious about us, and so they want to find out, how they can regain that. So that's one theory that was out there. But the truth is, one thing that nobody thought of, that I know of, is that if you've been telepathic for centuries, frowns and smiles are going to become obsolete. You don't need to show those. That's, you know, why would anybody smile or frown when your telepathic communication is far richer and delivering far more information about what you're saying or feeling? Tried to find a way out of there. A human-looking being, I took it to be a human being that was there to rescue me from these quote monsters. But so I went with him, took me out of there. This at that point was not in the woods like I thought. I thought I could just open a door and drop to the ground, I'd be back in the woods. But it was inside this big hangar like structure, whether it was a building or a larger craft somewhere, I couldn't tell. The light coming through these panels could have been sunlight, or it could have been some kind of artificial light that duplicated sunlight. But the feeling was cooler, and I could breathe better out there. But I still felt terribly wounded. Took me out of there to another part where some other beings that were dressed like him. Without the helmet, this time I started over with all my questions, but really basically babbling and not being very coherent, but they didn't seem inclined in the slightest to issue any verbal reassurances or tell me anything, which added to my panic, but they got me down on the table, put this mask over my face, and I went out. And the next thing I recall was waking up on the road in the cold, and my head was on my arm. I was kind of off to the side of the road, but there was a light above. I looked to see where the light was coming from, and it went off before I could fully turn in that direction. So I didn't see whether it was a light, like a fixture or a hatch of some kind closing, but it was only there for a second after that, and then it shot up into the sky. A very shiny, mirrored-looking thing, but more smoother and more rounded than the craft took me. But I recognized the lights of the town down below. I ran down into there, tried to get some people to come, and nobody would come to the door, whether they were sleeping because it's the middle of the night, or they think some crazy man is pounding on the door and screaming, and they better not come to the door. I don't know if anybody was even there. So I ran on down, went to the phone booth, and I went into the one on the far right there, and it was out of order. So I went into the middle one, and it worked. But the question I used to get was, did you have a quarter? But in those days, in that area, all you had to do is pick up the phone and dial on an operator, I'm calling my family, here's the number, And the extreme panic in my voice and her awareness of the hysteria that was gripping the whole community, she turned around and called the sheriff, which I don't know if it was legal, but I'm glad she did, because there was a friend of mine who said, when I got to that phone booth, the first thing I did was call him. And then when he wasn't home, then I called my family to come and get me. But that's not the way it happened. There was only one call made from there. And I'm glad that that was recorded in that way officially, because Philip Klass was claiming that I was never there at all. I was off some other place. That was one of his theories, hiding in some cabin somewhere. Now, these phone booths are still there, haven't been functioning phone booths for years. They're not connected to anything. They're just a local landmark. I couldn't get a picture without my motorcycle there, but I need to replace that. But when I called my family, my brother showed up, and I was just a total wreck. I couldn't talk. I was just, and I was hanging by a thread. And, he knew that the interrogation that I would be subjected to by the sheriff, he wasn't going to turn me over to them. Now, the sheriff secretly knew that I had been returned. But when Dwayne was out there getting his truck ready to leave town with me, Flake, played by Flake in the movie, but it was, they called him Blake in the movie, but it's Snowflake is named after two families, the Snows and the Flakes. The Flakes are the same family as Congressman Jeff Flake, and the lawmen in town were named Flake. My wife's great-grandma was a Snow, so they put the two family names together. We occasionally do get Snow, but some people are curious about why would anybody name a town Snowflake, but deputy that came by and said, what's going on here? And he says, oh, nothing. And so he went on home, and Dwayne took me to Phoenix, got in touch with some UFO investigators who said, look, if he's ever returned, we know how to deal with these things. We got people that know this stuff. So he took me to the recommended doctor, who turned out not to be a doctor at all, and he was just such a big quack that we turned around and left, and went out in the parking lot. People said, there he is! It was that kind of a thing where they chased us through traffic. But everybody was trying to track me down. The news was that I was returned. Sheriff insisted he has to see me to close out his missing persons report. And Dwayne did not want to turn me over to any kind of grilling because I didn't even tell him what had happened. I couldn't talk. You know, I was just in a nervous breakdown. It was just way over the top. But at that time, the premier UFO investigating organization in the world was APRO, the Aerial Phenomena Research Organization, soon to be eclipsed by MUFON when the founders of that of APRO passed away. But they figured out that I must be at Duane, called him, said, look, you know, we got real, genuine medical doctors in our membership. And so they had them come over, did an examination there. They make house calls, imagine that, you know. So the doctors, Dr. Saltz and Dr. Kandel, took me over real good and took me again later to the into their office, did more assessments. That's where the blood and urine samples were taken and sent to a medical examiner. It was very thorough. I had upper body x-rays, MRI, and EEG at Barrows Neurological, which is a world premier brain trauma center there in Phoenix. It's where Muhammad Ali came to when his difficulties developed. And he even donated a whole wing to that hospital. Ali was very into UFOs, and he came to the area where this happened, set up his training ring in the airplane hangar where I had done my private pilot training. And he even went to stayed at Bison Ranch, the people that own Bison Ranch there by Overgard. It's right next to Heber. It's the nearest place he could get in a luxury hotel to the site where this happened, that Ali stayed there. If you want to go online and go Angelo Dundee /Ali/UFOs, you'll see the Angelo Dundee talking about this, you know, that Ali had major sightings in connection with each of his major fights. So there was quite a bit of follow-up in that direction. But Ali even went to the boxing gym where my brother Duane trained. He's wearing a flower because he was the best man at my wedding. But he's somebody that I really have to give a great deal of credit to, because I wouldn't have survived that without his help. You know, his protection and his standing up. Standing up for me. He was a horseshoer, a horse trainer. His redneck friends did not take kindly to this report and him standing up there in the news media talking about this. He lost over half his customers right away. They didn't want nothing to do with this loony stuff. And so the APRO was the Aerial Phenomena Research Organization. It was thorough. And it was, you know, when the debunkers would attack, they would follow up with more tests. But Dr. James Harder, he performed the regressive hypnosis. You know, that was a lifesaver. I was under such tremendous pressure that, you know, it was the first time, even though several days had passed, that I hadn't told the whole story to my brother or to the sheriff, even though he'd come and talk to me. He could tell I couldn't handle it, you know. But Dr. Harder did the hypnosis and witnessed by like six actual psychiatrists, real psychiatrists. I also underwent these mental sanity tests I was telling you about, totally normal pattern of scores that were reviewed by Dr. Sprinkle there. He's the head of counseling at, or was at the time, at the University of Wyoming, and was interviewed by Dr. Jalen Hynek. You know, he had been the author of the term swamp gas. It was, people are familiar with that. You know, he actually invented that to explain a, bless you, to explain these things away for Project Blue Book. That was basically his mission, was to explain it all away. But when he left there, he left with the conviction that this is a real thing that needs further looking into, and he founded QFOS, the Center for UFO Studies, and then moved to Scottsdale, you know, part of Phoenix there, where he founded IQ4, the International Center for UFO Research. And he did quite a bit of research. He interviewed me, went and did an interview after having talked to me, and said that I had been the subject of a great deal of unfounded, unnecessary accusations. The real clincher on the pushback against our super debunker there was getting the FOIA, Freedom of Information Act, file on him. After he passed away, it was okay to find out the stuff about him. And he was no friend of the FBI. He had attacked the FBI for having enlisted Hynek's help in investigating reports. It was their job, you know, they have to do this, and they needed the top expert in the world. Dr. Hynek was an astronomer at Northwestern University. And this memo here is from J. Edgar Hoover, you can see that, to the director of the Central Intelligence Agency. At one time, our government denied there was a such thing as a CIA. Now you can turn on the TV and there's the director, but you know, even on an internal memo, they don't use his name. J. Edgar Hoover just says Director, Central Intelligence Agency. But this whole file, there's a lot of redactions about the classified stuff that's in there. And it's like pages and pages. These are direct quotes. And class is well known to us. He's deficient on all points of his argument, particularly concerning the credentials of Dr. Hynek, which could scarcely be better. On the other hand, Class has no such sterling reputation and has twice been under FBI investigation in connection with the unauthorized publication of classified information. His previous communications generally have been accusatory or argumentative in nature. And it doesn't get any better than that. What are they investigating him for? He was the editor of Aviation Week and Space Technology, was rubbing shoulders with a lot of military defense people, and apparently he had been selling information to the enemy, but the Newark office suggested reading the letter indicates Ryder is most likely not in full possession of his faculties. And a BU file, which is an abbreviation for UFO file, FBI file, number blah, 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 states, in view of Class's intemperate criticisms and often irrational statements he made to support them, it was recommended that the Bureau be most circumspect in any future contacts with him. So he had been investigated before, but then the curious thing for me is the 9 lines of redact right there. So what are we talking about there that they want to remain secret? And not to be of assistance to his government. That's the thing that concerns me, because right after this, there was a memo, I don't know if I have it on this file or not, where the FBI is basically turning their case against Class over to the CIA. That's how he became a CIA asset, and that's where the $10,000 bribe money came from. Class didn't have that kind of money, but when he came and tried to bribe Steve, the youngest guy on the crew, offered him $10,000 to say this didn't happen, Steve was in dire straits, and he almost took the money. And so this right here, the Dallas FBI office is maintaining this case in RUC status. So they can hold it over his head, but they're not going to file any charges. Right here in this one, it cannot be declassified for purposes of prosecution. But they don't tell him that. They tell him, we can drop the hammer on you if you don't do what we want. So the FBI's intention was just to investigate reports. But when it went to the CIA, their idea was, we need to suppress this. We need to make fun of this. We need to debunk this. So they needed something to replace Project Blue Book, which was what J. Allen Hynek used to do when he was making, you know, swamp gas kinds of comments. So they needed to replace with this debunker guy. And so that's where the money came from. Now, the $10,000 bribe offer is documented because the offer was carried by Deputy James Click, because Steve didn't have a phone. He lived out east of town where there weren't any phone lines, and we didn't have cell phones in those days. So James Click, Deputy Click, took the bribe offer to Steve, and so he couldn't deny it. But when it showed up in Bill Berry's book, Ultimate Encounter, it was quoted. Mike said, well, Steve, if you would do that, take this bribe, even though you know it really happened and would do it just for the money, then you'll spend the money alone and you'll be bruised. So when Class quoted Mike, he took the middle out of the sentence to reverse the meaning. He replaced it with an ellipsis, three little dots, to act like this is some insignificant thing that's been snipped out. But so it went from, even though you know it really happened and would do it just for the money, to, well, if you would take that bribe, then you'll be bruised, you know? So Class says it's evident that Mike is threatening Steve to keep him from revealing this conspiracy. And it was the exact opposite. That's the kind of sneaky attack tactics this guy used. Everything, he would just dirty tricks constantly. I mean, even publishing photos of people who made reports, and there was not just me, but others, where he would take film and he'd catch a frame where you were in mid-blink. What looks more sinister and dishonest than somebody with their eyes half open, you know? So it's all kinds of stuff like that. But there was further evidence that cropped up later. Paramount wanted to do an interview on the site. It had to be on the site right before the release of the movie. Well, there's 3 foot of snow out there. We can't get there. So they went to the ski run and rented these snow cats that got big 4 foot wide tracks, kind of like a tractor, but they're real light and they can just go over the top of snow drifts. So we made it out there, did the interview on the site, but we had a little trouble finding it exactly, and with the heavy snow. I thought it was just due to the snow. Found out later that Mike went back to the site when the snow melted and confirmed his suspicions. Thanks for cluing me in, Mike, but I found out later that he noticed that the trees around the edge of the clearing were bigger than they should be. So he took a core sample of this tree here. 92 was when we did the Paramount interview, and found that a tree that was 85 years old at the time of the incident had suddenly started growing and producing wood fiber at 30 some times the rate it had before. And this has been confirmed. We did a follow-up expedition there. Ben Hansen, the host of a TV show you might have seen called Factor Fake, he's a former FBI agent. He headed an expedition to the site where we went back again and looked at these trees and discovered an additional fact some years after the original that revealed that these trees were producing this thickened growth rings. There's always one growth ring for every year, but it was greatest on the side of the tree towards where the craft had been. It was one-sided, it was directional. And this was something that Mike didn't notice or have any way of knowing about back when this was discovered. He just happened to be standing in the clearing to take the core sample. He didn't want to harm the tree or kill the tree, so he cut it out and then very carefully formed a wooden plug and put caulking compound to seal it up so it didn't kill the tree. And then later, after the forest fire came through and killed all those trees, you know, we could get a complete cross-section, discovered not only was it directional, but it faded away after about 15 years. So this sudden burst in growth, you show these thickened rings on the side towards the craft, and then it kind of goes back to normal, like whatever radiation was there is no longer there. And another thing that Ben Hansen found, he went online and found out that the Scots pine trees in the vicinity of the Chernobyl nuclear accident had experienced the same kind of surge in growth. And to me, it was totally unexpected, because you would not think that radiation would make something grow faster. You would think it would just kill living things. But Ben found there was a number of scientific papers published about explaining the mechanism on how this would make these trees grow faster. But I need to download those papers and kind of get into that and find out what happened there. But the intense radiation there is evidenced by one other factor. When I got out of the truck, I left the door open, and the crewman that was sitting next to me was Ken Peterson, and he's now developed skin cancer on his right arm. Well, why don't I have cancer? I think they did a little fix-me-up stuff, you know, and I felt responsible and wanted to correct the damage. Tons of coincidences in connection with this whole thing to just make you shake your head. This right here was an area map of the state of Arizona. And then I went to look at where this incident happened, and it happened to be Area 51 out of all those. So what are the odds that it would be Area 51? Another coincidence was on the movie Back to the Future, when the time machine, they punch in the number to go back in time, it's 11-5-55. That's just exactly 20 years back from 11-5-75, the date of our incident. Now, you know, somebody in Hollywood may have thought, eh, that's clever, let's just use that date, but it could have been a coincidence too, who knows. But I'd bring my son with me to events like this, and people say, hey, you brought D.B. Sweeney with you. I go, no, this is my son, you know. And I don't look anything like D.B. Sweeney, but apparently my son does, because we took this picture, and, you know, same light blue eyes, you know, it's phenomenal how similar they looked. And I don't think that the casting people at Paramount knew about this similarity in appearance, but it is amazing. It's amazing, the similarity. And there's so many coincidences and synchronicities in connection with this. And one thing I did want to include, if we got time, is to discuss the change that's happened. At the time this happened, everybody knew that if you thought there was life outside of Earth, you were a kook. Only crazy people believe that, you know? That's tinfoil hat people. They talk about little green man. They make fun of it. And that was the government's approach to tamping this down. Now, they've since realized that this isn't working. It's not destroying their credibility. It's destroying ours. So they decided to kind of incrementally admit that there's something there. But at that time, it was tamp it down, make fun of it, and repress it. You're a kook. Well, at the time, we had this thing called the Drake equation, where they could calculate the number of civilizations in the Milky Way galaxy, but they had no idea how often a star would have planets. But this, about a year and a half ago, I think it was, the NASA said, well, now we know. It's a virtual certainty that every star has about a dozen planets. So the numbers you plug into the Drake equation are astronomically bigger, forgive me, than anything we would have thought back then. So the number of possible life-supporting planets is far, far higher than anybody would have guessed. Now, Michio Kaku, an astronomer, physicist, was on, I think it was Larry King, and he made the point that, you know, people keep imagining these civilizations as being maybe a few hundred years ahead of us, but In actuality, they could be, based on the age of these star systems, they could be hundreds of thousands or a million years ahead of us, you know? Our own technology is unrecognizable from 100 years ago, 200 years ago. If you could go back and show them a cell phone or any of our basic things, even 300 years ago, we didn't even have electricity. I mean, it was basically fire was all we had, you know? We've come a long way in a short period of time. So how far would they go in an enormous amount of time? It's preposterously arrogant that our learned men of science can make pronouncements about what's possible, what's not possible. To get here, it's going to involve interdimensional, all sorts of shortcuts, but I think we're getting there. We're on the cusp of a whole different kind of perspective on the likelihood of life from out there. Now some of those civilizations are not ahead of us, some of them are behind us. I mean, there's cave aliens out there, but they're not the ones that are visiting us. The only ones that are coming here are the ones who have reached the point of understanding physics to where they can leap, sidestep Newtonian physics to something much faster. And this interdimensional thing brings in a whole host of things that people sort of want to characterize as being semi-mystical or magical. And you know, when you get down to what's actually fact and what's truth and that sorts of thing, you know, the things that we take for granted would have seemed magical and in another time and place earlier. So, you know, when I tell people, audiences, just think of them as those people from way over there that we don't know very much about, they actually seem kind of disappointed. You know, I go ahead and say it, even though it's not popular. The truth is, a lot of the people that are interested in this and drawn to this subject are kind of following in on Hollywood's woo-woo kind of shock and awe approach to it. I hope that we can outgrow that to where movies that are all about aliens as invading monsters will go away just because nobody goes to see them. And we see the more sensible things. I do not believe that aliens are here to take over the planet. I think that's absurd. If you, you know, people are projecting. They're projecting human motives on beings far superior to us, and they're only superior because they're still there after millions of years. You know, if they had this kind of technology and they wanted to make war, they wouldn't be there anymore. To me, it's only logical that they get over this warlike, destroy the other kind of approach, because that's what works, you know, getting along and communicating and finding other ways to resolve differences. And really, with intelligence, there's going to be fewer differences to start with. You discover truth. So in my view, moral and ethical behavior does keep pace with technology because it has to. If they're going to survive, they're going to be adopt a higher form of what we call spiritual development. But I'm all for the idea that they are actually adhering to what science fiction has invented and calls the prime directive, the non-interference directive. They're not sneaking around and not landing on the White House lawn and saying, "Here we are, Mr. President," because they're not hiding from us. They're protecting us from ourselves. To have that kind of technology where they just land and say, "Here's a brand new box of matches, go play," is they're not going to do that because they know that would be destructive. The history of humanity, of explorers, of more developed nations contacting less developed nations, has always been destructive to the less developed nations. So this is, I believe, sort of a universal pattern. They're not hiding for their benefit. They're hiding for our benefit, but not completely hiding. The point I'm making here is that when you have a sighting, it's not aliens slapping their forehead and say, "Oh, dang, human spotted me again. I have to be more careful next time." No, you know, the degree of provability is, to a certain extent, it's being allowed, it's chosen, it's planned. And it's in order to condition us. gradually awaken us in a way that's not going to cause the kind of worldwide disruption that leads to economic collapse, you know. Free energy, no more oil. Wow, isn't that wonderful? Well, not really, you know. You know, the consequences have to be gradual and incremental to be non-destructive. So I think we're being conditioned. Our own government is kind of following the same pattern. Let them have a little bit of it at a time. Ease them into it, because that's what's necessary. People that say, oh, I want the government to throw open the books and tell us what they have. Well, you know, unfortunately, we do have enemies, countries on this planet who would love to destroy us. And letting them know the limits of what technology we might possess or might have gained. I believe there's some. I don't think they know everything, but they know a lot more than we do. But would it be wise for them to throw open the books and share it with our enemies? Because when they share it with us, they're sharing it with them too. So, you know, I'm kind of over characterizing the secrecy of the government as being nefarious, and might, in summary, be to our own benefit. I want to play that last video, if our AV guy could, because there's a song by a band named Travis with some, I'll tell you about that later, but it's got some lyrics about humanity getting along and settling the differences, and I think it's great. This is a band from Scotland. I really admire what's going on here, I know.
Side. Side. Side.
I value their perspective on this, you know, the lyrics, you know. The whole thing's a circle. You think someone's on the opposite side, but the circle only has one side. You think you're opposite of them, but we're really, you know, have the same kinds of wants and fears and sorts of things that, you know, you really got to study the lyrics. They're really, really pretty deep. And I was impressed by this. I asked them, you know, where'd you get the name Travis? But they deny it had anything to do with me. That's okay. You know, I'm proud of it. You know, if it's somebody else, that's fine. There's another band called the Travis Waltons. They're also from the UK, but they were freely admitting, yeah, we named it after you. Kind of hard to deny that one, but they gave me some T-shirts and albums and stuff. But they're more a little less serious, you know, kind of a fun band. Their greatest hit was on YouTube, introduced by Aaron Paul, the actor from Breaking Bad. So if you remember the famous line from Breaking Bad, the Travis Waltons are the bitch. Everything's the bitch if it's cool. But he introduces their song, which is not so cool. It's called Homewrecker, but kind of a fun band. It's kind of a compliment to have that kind of notoriety, to give me a point of a platform from which to, you know, try to make something good come of all this. So much harm is done. Make some good come of it somehow. You know, many people here, you know, have a lot of good ideas to, you know, help society and save the world. but they don't have the opportunity to be heard, so we all got to try to do our part. And so look into this band, Travis, and study the lyrics on side, because it's pretty deep stuff. And you know, other kinds of things that have happened. I saw a deal online where there was a discussion of a Joe Rogan show where, I don't know if everybody's heard of Joe Rogan, but he's number one podcast out there right now. And somebody said, they quoted Travis Walton saying, the number one problem that people have is everything has to be filtered through what they want and do not want to be true. And I thought that was really cool, because the show wasn't about UFOs. I didn't even brought UFOs, but they're quoting me on that point. And I'm happy that that one idea got out there without any of the attendant UFO stuff. But kind of good idea that they're getting away from the terminology and other sorts of thing, UAP, to make people understand that this is just those people from way over there you don't know too much about. But the real problem with it all being accepted and known is we're not ready. The problem is, look at how we treat each other on the basis of superficial differences in belief or appearance. How are we going to treat these little guys like this walking around amongst us? You know, it'd be a nightmare of the kinds of things that people would make up and invent. We've got to show them that we're ready by just being better to each other. Thank you.